Joel. It's a pleasure to be here. As Joel said, I'm Peter Boylan. I trained in Dublin and in London and worked in the United States after I finished my training for about 4 years, and then came back to Ireland in 1988 and have been working in Hollow Street ever since. I retired from clinical practice at the end of 2016 at midnight on December the 31st. That was the end of my clinical commitment, and I've been chairman of the Institute of Obstetricians and Gynecologists for the last couple of years. And that is a 3-year appointment, which finishes in September of this year. So that's just kind of the background of where I'm coming from. And my opinions and attitudes towards the question of abortion have been informed by my experiences over the years. And I moved from a very conservative attitude or opinion in my early days of training to where I stand at the moment, which is the result of years of experience of dealing with women, seeing the effect of restrictive laws on women and their families, and just the experience of working in other jurisdictions which have a more, if you like, realistic legislation surrounding the area of abortion. When you look at it, virtually every country in Europe has dealt with this problem. Theresa May. Nothing going to fall on my head at all. So the referendum that's going to be held on May the 25th is not a yes or no to abortion, because we already have abortion in this country, either by women travelling or by the importation of the abortion pills. And the pills are a major problem at the moment, insofar as they are imported illegally. Women are taking them without medical supervision. And taken without medical supervision, there are very significant dangers associated with taking these tablets. What happens is that women will take them in the wrong dosage, in the hopes they'll up the dosage, in the hopes that this will ensure that the termination or miscarriage occurs. And that has inherent dangers. And an example of that would be a woman, for example, who's had a previous cesarean section, who takes these tablets without medical supervision and then ruptures her uterus. That can be extremely serious, and that has happened. Now, the latest figures are that about 2,000 women a year are using the tablets that are imported illegally into this country. And those are figures from Women on the Web and Women Helping Women. But they're probably an underestimate of what is actually happening in the country at the moment. So that's one particular reason why, an example of why we have abortion in the country already, but it's dangerous. In 1983, when the referendum was passed, the Institute of Obstetricians and Gynecologists had no position on whether or not it was right to introduce this amendment to our constitution. But over the 35 years since then, we have seen the consequences of the Eighth Amendment, the unforeseen consequences. And many people who voted in favor of the Eighth Amendment had no idea of what the unforeseen consequences would be. And I'll go through those of those in a moment. But when I talked to my colleagues who were around at that time, who were voting and who might have campaigned to get the Eighth Amendment in, they say that had the opportunity then, they would not have voted or have pushed to have the Eighth Amendment inserted into our constitution. It has caused nothing but trouble for women and for doctors. So what are, in fact, are the problems that are caused by the Eighth Amendment? And the Eighth Amendment has caused enormous damage to women's health over the years, up to and including death. I have particular experience because I was the expert witness called by the coroner in the case of the death of Sunita Halappanavar. So I had an opportunity to forensically review her medical notes, and it is correct to state that she died from septicemia, and there is no argument. But the source of her septicemia, or her infection which killed her, was in her womb. and was in her womb because her waters had broken and the infection had ascended into her womb. And the fetus that she was carrying at the time was inevitably going to die from this infection. But unfortunately, there were errors in her care. But by the time it came to when they were treating her effectively, or trying to treat her effectively, and considered that they should now do a termination of pregnancy, they had to go and get a machine to check to see whether or not the fetal heart was still present before they initiated the process of doing the termination of pregnancy, at which stage she collapsed from septic shock, was rushed off to the intensive care unit where she miscarried, and of course after several days in the intensive care unit, she died. Had she had the termination of pregnancy on the day that she asked for it, she would now be alive, she'd have a family, she'd probably be living in Galway, and we would never have heard her. And it's interesting that her father, just the other day, said that he wanted her name used in the campaign to repeal the Alien Act because of what happened to his daughter in our country. You've heard of the story of Michelle Hart, Professor Louise Kenny, who looked after her in Cork, has given very good evidence about how she died as a consequence of the Eighth Amendment, because she couldn't have a termination in this country to enable her to continue on with treatment for her malignant myeloma, her cancer. She had to go to the UK, but there were inordinate delays. She didn't have a passport, etc. And her disease progressed, and she then died. There are others. Sheila Hodges is one, but there are others who are not in the public domain, and we can't talk about them because of issues of patient confidentiality. And that's one of the keystones of the practice of medicine, is the confidentiality between the patient and her doctor. And because of that, we can't talk about other cases. So how does it interfere at the moment with the practice of obstetrics in this country? I think the best way to illustrate it is to give you an example from my own experience in practice in the National Maternity Hospital in Wall Street. As a consultant, we obviously do duty on call. And I remember on a bank holiday weekend, on a Sunday afternoon, a woman in a similar circumstance to Savita Kalamanaga, who had ruptured membranes and who appeared to be possibly developing an infection. But her life was no way in danger at that stage. But I had to wonder, when would I be able to intervene to deliver her in order to avoid another Savita? The woman had no role in this decision-making process. And I also had to take account of the fact that perhaps there was another patient on the ward who would be aware of what was happening and who would report me to the guards if I intervened too soon. And if I intervened too late, well, the woman might have died. And that's the reality of practice today in this country, that doctors have to wait to see if they're on a knife edge. If I intervene too soon, will I end up in jail or custodial sentence or being reported to the guards, perhaps by a midwife, perhaps by a porter, perhaps by an emergency doctor, perhaps by a patient on the ward who's a member of some organization which is virulently opposed to termination of pregnancy under any circumstances. So that is the reality. And there are other circumstances, like women who bleed heavily, and we have to decide when, how much bleeding does she need to have, how many blood transfusions does she need to have before we can decide if she should have a termination of pregnancy. And the woman herself has no input into those decisions. The woman who was brain dead, but who was semantically supported on a life support machine because she was pregnant. And the Eighth Amendment meant that the doctors who were looking after her were confused as to whether or not they could continue to support, somatically support her, or whether they could adhere to the wishes of her family and turn off the machine and let her effectively finally die with some degree of dignity. And again, I was an expert witness in that case, which came to the High Court in the days before Christmas 2014. And that was one of the most distressing experiences of my entire clinical life. It was just awful. And the description of bringing her her children in to see her, and she deteriorated and swelled, and it would make a harm, so the children might have some chance of recognising the mother. It was just rightly described as a grotesque upset. The HSE consent policy also makes it clear that the Eighth Amendment interferes with the process of consent between the doctor and the patient, a pregnant woman, during the course of pregnancy with regard to delivery. So, for example, if a woman refuses to have a cesarean section, which a doctor feels is necessary, the doctors may are confused or may be under an obligation to take that woman to the High Court because of the interests of the unborn baby in those circumstances. That's no way to practice medicine. So what would happen if the Eighth Amendment is repealed? Well, in terms of how doctors would practice, there would be absolutely no change whatsoever, because the Protection of Life and Pregnancy Act would still hold true. And that's the act that I was working under when I described that one of my colleague again, similar to Sabine. It's the same sort of circumstances. You have to decide how close to death is a woman before you can proceed with a termination of pregnancy. And if our politicians don't legislate as we wish, we have the option of firing them by not voting for them in the next election. In this country, we're a relatively small country, and we have easy access to our politicians. I don't know of any other country that I've travelled in or lived in where you can bump into the Prime Minister in a pub and have a pint with him. It just doesn't happen in other countries. You won't meet Theresa May wandering around a pub in Shepherd Bush. You were likely to meet Andrew Kenny in some of the well-known pubs in Dublin, and he was approachable to talk to our current Prime Minister, Leo Varadkar, is in the same ilk, although not such a frequent of pubs, I don't think. So I think to say that we can't trust our politicians is inherently undemocratic, and it goes down the route of Trump, Breitbart, and alternative facts, alternative views, and so on. And it's not the way to function in a democracy. So moving on, supposing the Eighth Amendment is repealed, and the government has made proposals about what legislation they would like to introduce, and that has raised concerns among various people. So I think the best thing is I'll just address a few of those concerns. The first one relates to the question of disability, which is largely code word for Down syndrome. There's been a lot of talk about Down syndrome, much to the distress of parents of children with Down syndrome society. They just don't want it bandied around. However, it has been used. There are specific intention in the legislation to exclude disability as grounds for termination of pregnancy. And it is almost impossible to diagnose Downs before 12 weeks gestation, before 12 weeks of pregnancy. The process for diagnosing Downs syndrome is to do a screen test, which is not a diagnostic test, it's a screening test, which gives an indication of the chances of a child having a particular chromosomal problem, like, for example, Downs. That test takes 10 days to 2 weeks. It's not done in Ireland. When that test comes back, if it's a high risk, then the couple may proceed to have a diagnostic test done, or they may say, okay, well, look, we know, now we're prepared, and we can make preparations, we can talk to people in Down society, and so on. We know what's ahead of us. It's knowledge, which is very important for couples. Or they can decide that they want to have a definitive diagnostic test. That involves an invasive test of taking a sample from the placenta, the afterbirth, or from taking a sample of fluid from around the baby. The sample of fluid from around the baby is not done until 14 weeks at the earliest. The test of taking a sample from the placenta is done, it can be done at 11, 12 weeks. It carries with it a risk of miscarriage, and the test has to be sent abroad again. The very fastest you can get a result back is 3 days. That's with a very specific, guided, focused test, which is quite sophisticated and done with all the work, and that can come back in 3 days. Now, when you take into account counselling, allowing a couple to make, take time to make decisions, the implications of decisions that they might take, then you're certainly beyond 12 weeks. So while it is theoretically possible to make a diagnosis before 12 weeks, in practice, it doesn't happen. And in a practical sense, it's not really possible. And importantly, the government has said they will specifically exclude disability as an indication of termination of pregnancy. And that should act as a lot of reassurance for people who are concerned about that. The second issue relates to people who say, oh, there'll be termination right up until birth. That again is absolutely categorically wrong. Fetal viability is the ability of a baby to survive outside the womb. And that currently is around about 23 or 24 weeks gestation, which is extremely early. Of babies born at 23 weeks, about 70% of them die from the complications of prematurity. Of those born at 24 weeks, about 50% of them die from the complications of prematurity. The death rate gets progressively lower, so that by 27, 28, 29 weeks, you would expect almost all babies to survive if they're otherwise normal. But they do need a long time in the intensive care unit, and many of them, some of them will end up with significant disability as a result of the complications of prematurity, brain hemorrhage, and so on. Cerebral palsy, blindness, and deafness, requiring significant interventions like balance surgery because of complications of prematurity. So it's not simple or straightforward. However, the government have said that legislation would specifically, once viability is reached, we then would deliver the baby, which is what we do now. So if a woman has a serious complication of pregnancy in 23 or 24 weeks that she needs delivery, we would deliver the baby. The neonatal intensive care team would be there, and the baby would be taken to the neonatal intensive care unit. Every effort would be made to help that baby to survive. So any idea that doctors in Ireland would be doing abortions up to term is a lie, a complete untruth that needs to be knocked on the head. It's important to understand as well, when I was training, fetal viability was around about 28 weeks. It's now down to 23, 24 weeks. You'll see reports in the paper occasionally of a 20-week baby survived or a 22-week baby survived. Most of those, and they're very rare, would be errors of gestational age assessment. So they probably are more advanced than this. However, because of advances in neonatal intensive care, it's quite possible that those numbers will move backwards down to 22, 21 weeks or whatever. We just don't know. But certainly there are huge advances in neonatal intensive care that will be ongoing. And that's why it's important to have legislation rather than something in the Constitution, because legislation is flexible. And if something is not working or if it's unpalatable to the community, to the population at large, it can be changed by legislation, whereas something in the Constitution can't be changed. The next issue that people talk about is fetal abnormalities. And many of you will have heard Professor Malone, the master of the Rotunda Hospital, speaking eloquently about how patients with these conditions who wish to have their babies delivered early cannot have the same pathway of care as those women who choose to continue with their pregnancy. They have to go to England to have a termination of pregnancy or to deliver their babies early. And those babies are deeply loved, they're deeply missed, they're deeply grieved for. And of course, I would have experience of that. I remember one couple in particular who had a baby with anencephaly when the brain doesn't develop. And there is zero chance of that baby surviving after birth. And I saw them every 2 weeks throughout the pregnancy, took a lot of scan pictures. She knitted gloves and hats and scarves for the baby was born. And they held the baby, they put a name, and the baby died in a very short time, within minutes of birth. They found that a tremendously rewarding and satisfying experience for them. She came back on the next pregnancy, and it looked like the same thing was happening again. And she said, I can't do this again. I want a termination of pregnancy. So, people's circumstances differ, and we have a responsibility as doctors to look after patients in their own circumstances, not by something that's rigid in the Constitution that forbids us from looking after women and turns them into criminals by sending them abroad. The next issue that people are exercised about is the 12 weeks issue. Now, 12 weeks is a milestone of pregnancy. The other milestones are fetal viability and full term when fetal development has fully taken place. The first 12 weeks, if you take all pregnancies from the time of about 50% of them miscarry, usually before the woman even knows that she was pregnant, and miscarry before she has a period, or the embryo and the pregnancy comes away with the period. Of the remaining 50% of pregnancies or conceptions, about 20% miscarry. The overwhelming majority of those in the first 12 weeks of pregnancy. And that's why it's traditional that women and couples don't announce a pregnancy until the third month or the 12-week period, because then they know it's safe. But the likelihood of miscarriage occurring is very remote once you get to the 12-week time. So 12 weeks is a pregnancy in the first 12 weeks is it's fragile. And that's because it hasn't fully, the placenta, the afterbirth hasn't fully implanted. Fetal development is very dynamic at that stage and subject to all sorts of complications. The reasons why 12 weeks was chosen as a cutoff point is because it's in the first 12 weeks that the abortion pills can be used safely if given under medical supervision. Given under medical supervision and taken the correct way, the tablets are extremely safe. And countries where they are used, for example, in Norway, which is a population of 5 million, and a widely scattered rural communities. Medical abortion is used in about 90% of cases, and of those, the vast majority are less than 10 weeks. And the same holds true in Scotland, which again is a population of about 5 million, widely scattered rural populations, not too dissimilar from Ireland in many ways. So there are two good models, if you like, to look at. The other reason is because of the question of rape. The difficulty of establishing whether or not a rape has taken place, because there is no diagnostic test for rape. And it obviously has been a topic of much discussion because of the trial in Belfast in recent times. But there's no diagnostic test for rape. And if a woman has to say she's been raped in order to get a termination of pregnancy, then that means that a criminal act has occurred. And some man is responsible for that. Now that might have been her father, it might have been a cousin, it might have been a boyfriend, it might have been an acquaintance. But that criminalizes that person instantly. And so John McGurk, who's the communications director of the Save the Eighth, said on the radio the other day that perhaps we should look at the what he said was the Spanish model. Wrong. What she said was, if a woman reports a rape to the police, then she's entitled to termination of pregnancy. So I thought it was kind of strange that a man who was communications director for the Save the Eighth campaign was making a suggestion that an exception should be made for rape, as long as it was reported to the police. So there you go. So the other question is that if there are all of these women, and we know they are, traveling to the UK and importing pills. And if it is regarded that this is a criminal offence, then they should be punished because they're committing a criminal offence. And the custodial sentence is anything up to 12 years. 14 years. Now, the prison population, the female prison population in Ireland at the moment is 140 women. There are 140 women in Irish jails at the moment. If we are to criminalise the women who are having abortions in this country through the pills or abroad, we will add to the prison population on an annual basis by about 3,000 women a year. So our prison population will go from 140 women to 3,140 this year, 6,140 next year, 9,000, and so on. As I say in the States, you can do the math yourself. But that's the logical sort of extension of the criminalisation of abortion at the moment in the current regime.
I think I will stop there. I think finally, Professor Arul Kumaran, who gave evidence, who did the independent report on Sevilla Health and Average Care, and who concluded that the Eighth Amendment was responsible for the death as well. As he says, you're in favour of safe abortion or you're in favour of unsafe abortion.
Because if you don't have safe abortion, you will have unsafe abortion. And we already have that in this country. So what we need to do is to allow our legislators to legislate, guided by the population, guided by the Institute of Obstetricians and Gynecologists giving medical advice, so that we can have a safer regime, safer women, and that we can move into the 21st century properly, be the same as all of the other European countries, and